Not in the name of the Most High. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي أما بعد. All praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and peace be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah and I testify that Muhammad is the prophet and the messenger of Allah. Brothers and sisters, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this beautiful, blessed gathering that we get together for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remember Allah azza wa jal and to learn more about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah tonight we're going to talk about the rights of the leaders upon us and the rights of people upon their leaders, and what constitutes and defines a good, righteous, just leader, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the Quran, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the Hadith, and as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran al-Kareem, "Inna Allah ya'muru bil adli wal ihsani wa ita'i dhil qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands adl, which is justice. Adl is justice. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands justice upon His servants. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands His servants to be just, to be just with one another. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says in the Hadith al-Qudsi, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Inna harramtu dhulma ala nafsi wa ja'altuhu baynakum muharraman fala tadhalamu." I had forbidden oppression and injustice upon myself, and I forbid you to oppress one another and to be unjust to each other. So do not oppress each other. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Kullukum ra'in wa kullukum mas'ulun 'an ra'iyatihi." Al-imam ra'in wa mas'ulun 'an ra'iyatihi, wal-rajul ra'in fi ahli baytihi wa mas'ulun 'an ra'iyatihi. Wal-mar'atu ra'iyatun fi bayti zawjiha wa mas'ulatun 'an ra'iyatiha, wal-khadimu ra'in fi mali sayyidihi wa mas'ulun 'an ra'iyatihi. وَكُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in this first hadith that all of you are responsible and guardians, and every single one of you is responsible for their responsibility. كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ. Every single one of you is responsible, and every single one of you is responsible for their responsibility. Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, والإمام راع ومسؤول عن رعيته. The ruler, imam, I know it's got different meanings, several meanings. One of them is the one that leads the prayers. Another one is an imam who is a scholar. But here when the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is speaking about the imam here, Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم is talking about the ruler, the governor. And also you can refer to the Khalifa as the imam. You can refer to the Khalifa as the imam, which means he is the one that's at the forefront. That's why we call the imam that leads the prayer as the imam, because he's at the forefront, he's in the front line. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also says, and the imam, the ruler, is also responsible, and he is responsible for his responsibility. He's responsible for his flock, or he's responsible for his nation, or he's responsible for his people, his constituents. So Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam makes it very clear that every single person is responsible, and every single person is responsible for their responsibility, and the ruler, the Muslim ruler, is responsible, and he is also responsible for his responsibility, and his biggest responsibility is his people. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the grand imam sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a ruler, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was responsible, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was responsible for his responsibility. Likewise, his successors, his khulafa, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and the rest of the khulafa. And they are called khulafa. Why? Because they succeeded the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by taking the responsibility after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been the imams and the khulafa and the leaders of this ummah, the rulers of this ummah. And without a doubt, they were the best rightful khulafa, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam refers to the people that will come after him. Al-khulafa al-rashidun, the rightful khulafa. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had indicated, and Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam had indicated before his death to the one that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wants to be a khalifa, his successor after him, and that was Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was on his deathbed, he was ill sallallahu alaihi wasallam, And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was very unwell before his death. And then it was time for the salah. And the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam usually comes out and leads the prayers. So the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum waiting for the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to come out and lead the prayers. But then the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, after several attempts where the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tried to get up and get to the masjid, and every time he gets up, he collapses Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. At the end, the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Let Abu Bakr lead the prayers. Let Abu Bakr lead the prayers. Order Abu Bakr to lead the prayers." So they went and looked for Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they couldn't find him. So the one that the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told him to go and tell Abu Bakr to lead the prayers, he saw Umar ibn al-Khattab, he told him, "You lead the prayers." When the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam heard Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu leading the prayers and reading the Quran al-Kareem, because the masjid of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was connected to the house of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and Umar ibn al-Khattab was loud. He was known for his loud voice. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam heard the loud voice of Umar ibn Khattab leading the prayers. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Why didn't Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu lead the prayers? I ordered the Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu to lead the prayers." And he said, "By Allah, Allah and his messenger only insist upon Abu Bakr to lead the prayers." And that's why when the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum had given the bay'ah to Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they said the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam accepted him for our deen, then surely the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam would have accepted him for our dunya. If the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam accepted Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu for our deen, then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam would have accepted him for our dunya. So if the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam accepted Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu to lead the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum in their prayers, to lead the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum in their rituals, in their worships, then surely the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have accepted Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu to lead the Muslim Ummah and to lead the Muslim nation. So that are the Khulafa after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also referred to them as Imams. And that's why Khalifa, what does Khalifa mean? Khalifa means successor, someone that comes after you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to us as Khulafa. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your Lord, informed the angels that He'll be establishing and creating a khalifa on the face of this earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to us as human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to us as khalifa, which means we succeed one another. So one generation comes, then it's followed by another generation, and another generation succeeds the predecessors and the previous generation, and that's why it's called khalifa. So Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was the first khalifa of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he's the first successor of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When Abu Bakr passed away, it was Umar ibn Khattab that was chosen by Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. There was no elections, there was nothing. He was chosen by Abu Bakr radiallahu, he was appointed by Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu amongst each other said, "What, we're going to call him Khalifat Rasulullah? And then the one after Abu Bakr, after Umar, we're going to call him Khalifat Rasulullah. And then the one that comes after Umar ibn Khattab, we're going to call him Khalifat Rasulullah. So after 10 Khulafa, we're going to call Khalifat Rasulullah. We need to shorten it. So subhanAllah, while the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum was sitting down and discussing this topic, one man, one of the messengers from one of the Muslim governors, comes to the masjid of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum was sitting down discussing some of the affairs of the Muslim Ummah. So he said, Ya Amira al-Mu'mineen, or the leader of the believers. So they all paid attention, said, "Wallahi, that's an excellent title. Let's call him Amir al-Mu'mineen, which means the leader of the Mu'mins." So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also says, والإمام راع ومسؤول عن رعيته. And the Muslim leader, he's also a guardian, he's also responsible, and he's responsible for his responsibility. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam continues to say, and the man, he is responsible, and he's responsible for his responsibility, and his responsibility is his household. والمرأة راعية. And also the female, the woman, she's also responsible, and she's also responsible for her household. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, and also the servant, he's responsible, and he's responsible for his master. وَكُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَمَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ. And every single one of you is responsible, and every single one of you is responsible for their responsibility. So we're all responsible in one way or another, but some of us have different responsibilities than others. and some of us have bigger responsibilities than others. But at the end of the day, we are all responsible. And if we don't have anyone to be responsible over or guardian over, then you are responsible for yourself. So be responsible over yourself. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam makes it very clear that the Imam, the Muslim leader, he is responsible for the Ummah. He's responsible for this responsible. He's responsible for this Ummah. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam makes it very clear that he is responsible for the Muslim Ummah, for the Muslim nation, in which he needs to take care of this nation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question him over this responsibility. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala questioned him over this responsibility. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran Kareem, Inna aradna al-amanata ala al-samawati wal-ardi wal-jibali fa'abayna an yahminnaha wa ashfaqna minna wa hamalaha al-insan innahu kana dhaluman jahula. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention in the Holy Quran that we had offered distrust to the heavens, to the earth, to the mountains. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the heavens, the earth, and the mountains could not even bear or carry distrust. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَحَمَلَهَا الْإِنسَانِ. So this human being carried distrust. What trust are we referring to? What trust is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala implying here? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the trust which is La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, the Quran and Sunnah, which is in summary Islam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us all responsible for this great responsibility which is Islam. And every single one of us is responsible for this great responsibility which is Islam. Carrying the Quran and Sunnah. Taking care of the Quran and Sunnah. Advocating and promoting and propagating the Quran and Sunnah. It's all our responsibility. And subhanAllah, just pay attention and take heed to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that the heavens, the earth, the mountains could not even carry this great responsibility, but you decided to carry it. You decided to carry this responsibility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had offered and initially offered to the heavens, to the mountains, to the earth, and they could not even carry it. The following hadith, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, ما من عبد يسترعيه الله رعية يموت يوم يموت وهو غاش لرعيته إلا حرم الله عليه الجنة. Subhanallah. Ajib. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that any servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts him in a position of responsibility, of taking responsibility of his people, and he does not fulfill that responsibility and take care of his people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cast him in the hellfire. He'll never enter the Jannah. So subhanAllah, these days you've got people are fighting over this responsibility, and people want to be leaders, and people want to be presidents, and people want to be this, and people want to be that. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, if you're not going to fulfill the responsibility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never let you enter the Jannah. Yeah, it's a big, big responsibility. People these days are fighting over them. People these days are fighting over responsibilities and positions. But then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, if you're not going to fulfill this responsibility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you responsible of, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never let you enter the Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve us. ما من أمير يلي أمور المسلمين ثم لا يجهد لهم وينصح لهم إلا لم يدخل معهم الجنة. Any leader that he is a leader of the Muslims, he does not work hard for them, strive towards their betterment and their advancement, does not give them nasiha and take their nasiha, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not let him enter the Jannah with them. Responsibility. And subhanAllah, it's part of our natural instinct that we love leadership. We love to be in the spotlight. We love fame. But as one of the scholars said, or one of the Sahaba said, it is fame in this dunya, punishment in the hereafter. Regret in the hereafter. Fame in this dunya. Later on, you're going to regret and enter the hellfire if you're not going to fulfill this responsibility. And subhanAllah, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most responsible leader. And then it was Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and then it was Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Umar ibn al-Khattab used to walk the streets of Medina during the night, making sure that everyone has been serviced by the Islamic government or the Islamic state, making sure that people are in peace and security. And people will say that to him, why are you doing this? Why are you burdening yourself and walking around the streets of Medina at night? Don't you fear on yourself? He said, what I'm going to say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if there's anyone around the world who's under my responsibility, if this person is not being looked after. If this person is not looked after. Subhanallah, and I recall a story of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, once he went past a mother with a group of children, and her children were crying. So Umar al-Khattab went past this mother and saying, "What's wrong with your children? What's wrong with your kids?" She said that my kids are crying because there's no food. And Umar al-Khattab was shocked. And then she said, and Umar ibn al-Khattab is the Muslim leader. I'm going to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I'm going to ask Allah azza wa jal to judge him over this responsibility. And she's speaking to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. And Umar ibn al-Khattab had a servant with him, had someone who was assisting him. So Umar al-Khattab went to Bayt Mal al-Muslimin, which is the treasury of the Muslims. And Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu carried food on his back. And his servant saying to him, "Umar, let me carry this on your behalf." "You don't have to carry it. You're Amir al-Mu'mineen. You're the most powerful man on the face of this earth." And yes, at that time he was the most powerful man on the face of this earth. And the servant of Umar al-Khattab saying to him, "No, let me carry this. Let me take it." And Umar al-Khattab said, "No, let me carry it. Who's going to carry my sins and responsibilities in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hereafter?" And then he went to that mother, where she had a group of children, her sons and daughters. Her children were crying from starvation and hunger. And Umar al-Khattab himself started to cook for him. And then Umar al-Khattab gave that food to that lady. And then his servant said, "That's it, alhamdulillah, we fulfill that responsibility." So Umar al-Khattab said, "By Allah, I'm not going to walk out of here until I hear those young kids, those young children, laughing and smiling the way I heard them crying." Subhanallah, responsibility. Who does that these days? Especially in the Muslim world, the very moment that you enter a palace or a responsibility, that's it, forget about it. That's it, no connection. Disconnect yourself from the entire world. Disengage from everyone else. Only before election, of course. But you know, in our Muslim countries, there's no elections. Subhanallah. Very, very, very disappointing these days. Look at the khulafa of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Very responsible. When the news reaches Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, there's a group of Muslims who pray, who fast, who attend the jama'at of Qur'an Masjid, but they stop paying zakah. They said, "Why should we pay zakah after the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam?" So Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu was with Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when Abu Bakr said that statement, he said that, "Wallahi, I'll declare war on them. I'll declare war on them." Umar Khattab was shocked. "You're going to declare war on people who are praying, who are fasting, attending the jama'ah, they've got a masjid, praying jama'ah together, making the adhan?" The news reaches Abu Bakr that there's a group of Muslims who stop paying zakah, but they pray and fast and everything. And Abu Bakr says, "Wallah, I'll declare war on them." Umar says to him, "Why would you even want to do that? These people are praying and these people are fasting, but they're not paying zakah." So Abu Bakr became very angry, and he said, "By Allah, I'll fight them. I'll wage war against them. I'll fight them and wage war against them even over a small goat that used to give it to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." And then he grabbed Umar ibn Khattab and he said, "Akhawarun fil jahiliyyah, jabbarun fil Islam." You're a coward during the jahiliyyah before Islam, and now you're becoming, you're a tough person, you're brave in the jahiliyyah, but right now you are becoming very coward in Islam. Subhanallah. Responsibility. And unfortunately, these days we are very far off from any responsibility. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make this dua: "Allahumma man walla min amri ummati shay'an fashqq alayhim. Wa man walla min amri ummati shay'an farafiqa bihim farfuq bihi." The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make this dua. He used to say, "Oh Allah, anyone from my nation who is leading my nation, who is hard on them, oh Allah, become hard on him. And if it's easy on them, oh Allah, become easy on him." That's the dua the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make. Anyone that's easy on the nation, ya Allah, make it easy on them. Anyone that's hard on the nation, ya Allah, make it hard on them. Responsibility. It's all that responsibility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to take. The other hadith: "كانت بنو إسرائيل تسوسهم الأنبياء كلما هلك نبي خلفه نبي وإنه لا نبي بعدي وسيكون بعدي خلفاء فيكثرون قالوا يا رسول الله فما تأمرنا قال أوفوا ببيعة الأول فالأول ثم أعطوهم حقهم واسألوا الله الذي لك فإن الله سائلهم عما استرعاهم." The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in this hadith that in the previous nations, in the nation of Bani Israel, they used to have their prophets and messengers that used to lead them. And then the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that there's no prophet or messenger after me. And after me, you're going to have a lot of successors, a lot of khulafa. And even Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam speaks about the different succession, even the different era and different period, where the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, after me there'll be a period of khulafa who are khulafa rashidun, rightful and right, upright khulafa, upright successors after me, upright khulafa after me. Then the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, right after that there'll be a khulafa, they'll take from one another like a kingdom. Then the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, after the era there'll be khulafa which is more an enforceable, like a military type of khilafa, in which that's something that you could see in the Muslim world encountering. And then the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, وَبَعْدَا تَكُونُ خِلَافَةً عَلَى نَهْجِ النُّبُوَّةِ. After that, then there'll be a khilafa according to the way of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And that's a form of optimism that the future of Islam will rise and will be in accordance to the way of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in this hadith that Bani Israel used to have their prophets and messengers that used to lead them, and then there's no prophet and messenger after me, and after me there'll be a lot of khulafa, Muslim leaders. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was asked, oh Messenger of Allah, what do you order us to do? What do you order us to do? What do you want us to do? So the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, fulfill the pledge. Because when we have a khalifa in Islam, we have to give him a pledge. A pledge of allegiance. That's how we surrender, or not the word surrender, but adhere or subscribe to a khalifa. So when you have a khalifa, Muslim leader, Islamically you have to give him bay'ah. Bay'ah means a pledge of allegiance, which means I accept you to be my leader. And obviously it's not going to be that, like, let's say there's 1.8 billion Muslim, that this khalifa expects 1.8 billion Muslim to get to him. You've got people who are considered to be in the Sharia Ahlul Halli Wal Aqd, who are considered to be the major people and major parties in the Muslim world, like the scholars and the leaders of tribes, and they're the ones who speak on behalf of the rest of the people, the rest of the community. So the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, fulfill your pledge of allegiance. The first one, then the one that follows it. And fulfill their rights. And ask Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala to give you your rights from them. Because Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will ask them and judge them over what Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala had made them responsible over. So Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will ask them, you have a responsibility as a follower, as someone who subscribes to this khalifa, or subscribes to this leader. You give them the pledge of allegiance, you surrender to their orders if it's in line with the Sharia. And obviously, la ta'ata li makhluqin fi ma'siyat al-khaliq, there's no obedience to the creation when it comes to disobeying Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, the creator. And if they don't fulfill your responsibility, you fulfill your responsibility. So it's not tit for tat. Oh, he's not going to be good to us, we're going to be bad to him. He does not fulfill our responsibility, we're not going to fulfill his responsibility. Because at the end of the day, the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in this hadith, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is going to question them in the hereafter. They'll be responsible for what they have. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam continues to say, مَنْ وَاللَّهُ شَيْئًا مِنْ أُمُورِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَأَحْتَجَبَ دُونَ حَاجَتِهِمْ وَخَلَّتِهِمْ وَفَقْرِهِمْ اِحْتَجَبَ اللَّهُ دُونَ حَاجَتِهِ وَخَلَّتِهِ وَفَقْرِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, whom Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala gives him the responsibility of the Muslim Ummah, which means the leadership of the Muslim Ummah. And this person deprives the Muslim Ummah from their needs, from their necessity. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will deprive him in the hereafter from his need and his necessity. Subhanallah. Yes, people are fighting over leadership and people want to be leaders over this and people want to be leaders over that, and this person wants to be the head of this and this person wants to be head of that. But don't forget, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is going to ask you in the hereafter, and Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is going to judge every single one of us over this. And that's why the Muslim Ummah should always choose the most suitable just leader to lead them, whether on a small scale or a big scale. And the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam describes the one that he's a just leader, Imamun Adil, he'll be from amongst those that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will shade under his shade, with his no shade except his shade in the hereafter. Sab'atun yudhilluhumullahu fi dhillihi yawma la dhilla illa dhilluh, Imamun Adil. From amongst those that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will shade in the hereafter, when there's no shade except the shade of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, especially when the sun is only a few meters above your head. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, Imamun Adil, the first one is a just ruler, a just leader. That he was just within himself and he was just to his people. And subhanAllah, we've got great examples from our predecessors, from the khulafa of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the successors of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who are considered to be our predecessors. We have great examples of their justice, of their righteousness, of their piety. Whether they are the first khulafa during the time of, or from the time of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, such as Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and the great khulafa that came after him, or even later on, even later on. And that's why you have, for example, a khalifa that came after the death of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam by about 67 years, if not more, Umar ibn al-Abdul Aziz. And the khalifa Umar ibn Abdul Aziz only ruled for 3 years or less, under 3 years. And the scholars also speak so highly of him, they consider him to be the fifth rightly khalifa. The fifth rightly khalifa from the Khulafa al-Rashidin. That's how just he was. That's how fair he was. That's how humble he was. That once someone was walking into the masjid and he tripped over his feet. And he said, are you dumb? Are you a donkey? He said, no, I'm only Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And this is, you're talking about a powerful man, a leader. SubhanAllah, you're talking, like when you talk about examples about a leadership or about a leader, you're talking about the greatest of successors of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, starting with Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and then came after that Al-Hasan and Muawiyah and the rest of the Khulafa. And yes, throughout history, there were Khulafa who were good in one sense, but they had corruption in another sense. No one is perfect, and Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is going to judge him at the end of the day. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is going to ask him in the hereafter. But the greatest of examples is Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, then Umar, then Uthman, then Ali, and then the rest of the Khulafa in different orders. But we as Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we believe that the greatest man after the prophets and messengers is Abu Bakr, then Umar. And then there is difference of opinions when it comes to Uthman comes third, or Ali comes third, and some scholars said both of them come third, and one of them said Uthman comes before Ali, another one said Ali comes before Uthman. But at the end of the day, they are great Khulafa. At the end of the day, they are great Khulafa, they are great successors of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, leaders of this Ummah, and they displayed and portrayed the best example of being righteous people who fear Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala and great leaders and just leaders who led this Ummah. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, إِنَّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَلَى مَنَابِرَ مِنْ نُورٍ الَّذِينَ يَعْدِلُونَ فِي حُكْمِهِمْ وَأَهْلِيهِمْ وَمَا وُلُّوا. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that the just leaders are on pulpits of light in the hereafter. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will make them stand on pulpits, on mimbar, on podiums of light, which is a sign of honor and respect. Because of their justice, and because of them fulfilling the rights of their people, and because of their wisdom. خِيَارُ أَئِمَّتِكُمْ الَّذِينَ تُحِبُّونَهُمْ وَيُحِبُّونَكُمْ وَتُصِلُونَهُمْ وَتُصَلُّونَ عَلَيْهِمْ وَيُصَلُّونَ عَلَيْكُمْ وَشِرَارُ أَئِمَّتِكُمْ الَّذِينَ تُبْغِضُونَهُمْ وَيُبْغِضُونَكُمْ وَتَلْعَنُونَهُمْ وَيَلْعَنُونَكُمْ. The Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in this hadith that the best of your leaders are those that you love them and they love you. You pray for them and they pray for you. You pray for them, you make dua for them, and they make dua for you. And the worst of them are those that you hate and they hate you. And you curse and they curse you. SubhanAllah. Now, there's a lot of examples, don't worry about that. In the Muslim world, we're not talking about the first phase or the first part. Not those that you love and they love you, you pray for them and pray for you. We're talking about the second part. That you hate and they hate you. That's what you've got in the Muslim world, unfortunately. Rarely that you'll find a leader that people love and he loves his people. And people make dua for, and they make dua for their people. Now, people hate them, and they hate their people. And they curse them, and they also curse their people. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ قُلْنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ فَلَا نُنَابِذُهُمْ أَفَلَا نُنَابِذُهُمْ قَالَ لَا مَا أَقَامُ فِيكُمْ الصَّلَاةَ لَا مَا أَقَامُ فِيكُمْ الصَّلَاةَ. SubhanAllah, look at the wisdom of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So one of them said, oh, Messenger of Allah, should we get against him, rebel against him, revolt against them and take them down? The Prophet Muhammad said, no, as long as they're allowed to pray. No, as long as they're allowed to pray. What did the Prophet Muhammad encourage them for them to revolt against their leaders? Because revolting against a leader sometimes can cause a bigger fitna in the ummah than the fitna that they are currently doing. sometimes revolting against your leaders, it can cause a bigger fitna in the community than the existing fitna, because they are corrupt and they cause corruption, but revolting against them. If revolting against them is going to bring good, it can be spoken about. I'm not going to say it cannot be spoken about. But if you're going to revolt against your leaders, you're only going to cause havoc and you're going to cause more problems, then the Prophet Muhammad says, do not get against them as long as they allow you to pray and they are praying themselves. Subhanallah, when you talk about leadership, you talk about justice, upright leaders, just leaders, the first people that cross your mind beside the Prophet Muhammad, because at the end of the day, everyone's going to say he's a prophet and messenger. Obviously, the Prophet Muhammad is, without a doubt, the greatest leader and the most just leader. You think about the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, who led after the Prophet Muhammad, their great example, what they've displayed as leaders, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, subhanallah. What they've displayed as leaders is just a great example. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, during his leadership as a Khalifa of the Muslim Ummah, in less than 3 years, 2 years and a half. And then Umar ibn Khattab, about 10 years, and then Uthman, similar amount of years, then Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Great leaders. When you talk about them, you talk about great leaders. And I'm sure you've been hearing some of their qualities and their achievements and their leadership accomplishments from Sheikh Abdullah on Mondays when he speaks about the khulafa of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On Monday, Sheikh Abdullah, every Monday, he's been talking about the khulafa of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the great successes of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and their contribution to Islam, their leadership, their justice, their contribution to Islam. And subhanAllah, you'll never ever find greater leaders than them, because their leadership was based on the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We fear Allah azza wa jal, you take care of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you don't fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're not going to take care of the creation of Allah azza wa jal. And that's why Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a great leader. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu was a great leader. Uthman and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhumah were great leaders. And other khulafa that came after him were great leaders. And that's why they ruled the world. They were the world leaders. They led the world. They were the most feared people on the face of this earth. What made them rule the world? Not because they had numbers. On the contrary, they had less numbers than anyone else. Not because they had weapons. They had less weapons than everyone else. Because they feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they fulfilled the rights of their people. As been mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They fulfilled the rights of their people. They fulfilled the rights of the ummah, their community. And whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a responsibility, remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you that, over that responsibility. So let us fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with whatever responsibility that we have. And every single one of us is responsible for their responsibility. And the first responsibility that you've got in your life is your personal life and your family. You are responsible for yourself and you are responsible for your family. So if we can't even take care of ourselves, we can't take care of our families, we can't take care of our families, we can't take care of this ummah. And these days you find people want to fight over leadership. They want to fight over this responsibility. But when you look at him, he's not even responsible within himself. He can't even take care of his own family, let alone for this person to take care of the responsibility of the community. Subhanallah. If you can't even take care of your own family, you can't take care of other people's families. If you can't even take care of yourself, you're not going to take care of your family. Don't fight over a responsibility that you can't bear. Don't fight over a responsibility that you can't fulfill the rights of that responsibility. Unfortunately, this ummah, even our community here in Australia, even our community here in this country, is embedded with corrupt leaders. Heads of organizations and associations, embedded with corruption. The worst of people in the community are presidents and chairmen of societies. Islamic societies, some of them don't even pray. What Islam are you talking about? What Islam are you talking about? You're not even praying and you've got a prayer hall. What do you even chair an organization that has a prayer hall when you don't even pray? That means you don't even believe in the objective. You believe in the chair. People will fight over the chair. People will do anything for the chair. People will do anything for a position. And some people will start talking about, you know what, I could do this and I could do that. If I've got this position, I've got that position. Well, you know what, to serve your deen, to serve your community, nothing stops you from serving your community, whether you're in a position or not. I don't have to be a president or a chairman of an organization for me to do something for Allah. I could be serving the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with or without it. You need to be responsible. And every single one of you here, my brother and my sister in Islam, are responsible. And the bare minimum that you are responsible for is yourself and your family. Take care of yourself and your family. Take care of your children. Take care of your kids. They are your responsibility. They're not other people's responsibilities. You know how many times I get fathers come and speak to me about their kids? And then I test them. I say to them, okay, I've got a lesson every Thursday. What then you bring me? I'm busy. If you don't even take care of your own kid, if you can't even take care of your own son, you expect other people to come take care of your own son? Wake up to yourself. We are responsible. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us responsible for our responsibility. I'm responsible for my responsibility. You are responsible for your responsibility. We differ on the scale that we are responsible on. But at the end of the day, every single one of us is responsible. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made it very clear. As a man, you are responsible for your responsibility, and that's your household. As a woman, you are responsible for your responsibility, and that's your household. So as a father, you are responsible for your family. As a mother, you are responsible for your family. And that is a responsibility that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to ask you about. He's going to ask me about it. He's going to ask you. He's going to ask every single one of us ever. Lead by a good example within your family before you start thinking about leading other people. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who listen and hear. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from you and I. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who lead by a good example and are responsible for their responsibility. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Subhanaka Allah bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Every Muslim dreams to be up in Jannah. A pious person's destiny. Inshallah, in Jannah.